Hi, everybody. So thank you for being here. We are going to start this afternoon session. And the first part will be the theory session. And we'll start with Francis Bach, who has done a lot of work on various stuff. So he will tell us about discriminative clustering and applications to a large number of classes and segmentation. Thank you.
Okay, thanks Mustafa for the introduction, and I would like to thank the organizers for the invitation to come here today. So since I don't work with extreme number of classes, I chose a topic which I think is relevant, which is a topic which I've been worked on in the last 10 years with various collaborators which you see here. This started with Zaid Archaoui, then Armand Joulin, and then a sequence of students. And yes, so this is a technique that I will describe now. I will first focus of the basic setup, which is like clustering. And I will show that by the formulation which will end up in a convex program. Okay, I have not changed the last 10 years. Convexity remains important. And I will show like some analysis. And finally, in the last part of the talk, I will present like some application to image segmentation and to pre-clustering for large numbers of classes. So first, a big disclaimer before I start. Some of that work is pretty old, and some of those slides are pretty old. They are probably outdated in terms of references. So if you feel your work should belong there, send me an email and add them back. So just to start, so this is like the usual like generative clustering. So for example in k-means, what you want to do is to find like cluster centroid so that your points are close to those cluster centroid. And the underlying assumption typically is that you have a set of rounded cluster. So here, for that type of data, then k-means will typically not work. So what is discriminative clustering? The goal will be to put labels on those points so that, given those labels, you have a maximal separation between the two clusters. So you want maximal linear separation. So this, I refer to k-means as generative because you're trying to model the data. And discriminative is you try to find labels that can be maximally separated. And this dates back from a very nice paper by Xu, Schurmans, and colleagues at NIPS 12 years ago. So what we've been doing, so the way to formulate this is now I want to have some features phi of x. So this is my data. And I want to assign labels y. Then I want to learn a classifier on top of my data x and y, and looking for a linear classifier regularized by some Euclidean norm. And the goal now will be to minimize not only with respect to your W and B, like a regular learning, but also with respect to y. So this is like this becomes a non-convex problem. And one of the contributions that we had with Zaid 10 years ago was to look at the square loss. And as I will mention several times today, the square loss is very nice because it's jointly convex in these two arguments. And for the square loss, this becomes a quadratic problem, which you can solve in closed form. And at the end, you end up with a minimizer with respect to W and B, a minimal value after you minimize over W and B, which is of that form, which is the trace of a certain matrix A, and the experts will recognize the kernel matrix and the centering matrix times YY transpose. So at the end, given the labels Y, the linear separability is a quadratic form in Y. So now the goal is I want to minimize this quadratic form in Y, but now I have to put some constraints. So if I don't put any constraints, just like unit norm, I cover just the largest, right here, the smallest eigenvector of A, but I may want to put constraints, for example, I want to have binary set of labels. So this is where the convex relaxation comes in. Now I want to minimize this trace of Y transpose AI with respect to my class labels. And now, because this is formulated in terms of M, which is Y transpose, then I have this usual like convex relaxation. Why? Because this matrix M is composed of minus 1 and 1. It's 1 if you're in the same class and minus 1 otherwise. And the usual like convex actor approximation is to use like first positive semi-definiteness. You have a product of matrices. The diagonal is always equal to 1. You're always with yourself. And if you remove the rank constraint, you get like a convex problem. And once you have it, once you have like a matrix M, you recover Y by just thresholding the eigenvalues. Okay, so this is very very simple technique. And of course, the key computational component is to solve this semi-definite program. And here, I will not give details. But before I don't give details, let me add some extra elements. First, if you want to, you need to add constraints. Why? Because if you try to maximally separate two classes, you can put all the elements in a single class. This will be the perfect linear separation. So you need to ensure some balance in the classes. And as I will show later, you can add also some partial supervision if you want to do semi-supervised clustering. So a bit of optimization. So just to highlight that those problems can be solved like reasonably efficiently, not if you have millions of data points, but if you have like tens of thousands, then this scales up pretty well from like the entire point techniques, which don't scale, to what we did using spectral techniques with Zaid, to more recent work, which we did both with Armand Joulin and Jean Ponce, or with like recent students. Essentially, if you know how to do context optimization, you can always bring something which was very, very slow to something which is like reasonably fast, which can scale up to like 30,000 data points. So from the start, if you tell me I have 1 million data points, I say fine. You can simply do some pre-clustering. Okay, I don't believe in convex relaxations which are run on the raw data. You can always lower dimension with something which is much simpler and much faster, like k-means, and then you can run on the clusters of k-means. Now let's compare with k-means. So this is a clustering technique. So this is like diffrag. So I forgot to give the name, so we call that diffrag for reasons I totally forgot. And so here, the idea in diffrag is you want to find labels so that if you take a linear prediction, then you get the smallest possible residual loss. K-means is the opposite. You want to find labels so that if you learn the best centers according to those labels, you get a minimal squared error on your data. So K-means, we model the data, and we model the labels. So it's different. And the key will be what we have at the next slide. This will be a key difference, and let me tell it immediately, is that we can rely on existing techniques for supervised learning. Okay, so let's say I work on images, then there are a bunch of techniques to do like supervised learning on images, and I can reuse the exact same techniques with that type of discriminative clustering, and I cannot really use those if I use basic k-means. So what we did, it was like NIPS from 12 years ago. You could have a paper with that type of simulation. We just took k-means in 2D, and we add take a data set like this with, of course, no labels. We add noisy dimensions. And as you get more and more dimensions, the problem gets harder and harder. And here we just look at how slow or fast the methods are not working anymore. So k-means does degrade very quickly. After like 3 dimensions, it doesn't really find the clusters, whereas our technique is much more robust to those noisy dimensions. There's a bunch of extensions which we recently submitted with my students Nicolas Flammarion and my postdoc Bala, which is first going from single label to multiple labels. So I don't want to get into this today, but if you want more than a single, that two classes, then there are extensions which are like very natural. We can add sparse penalty, so this is also a possibility. And what Nicolas was able to show is that we can prove, measure the robustness to irrelevant dimensions. So here, what you see on the plot on the left, this is like the clustering error after running the techniques with various number of noisy dimensions and various data set sizes. And if N is large, the problem gets easier. You manage to recover your clusters. And if D is not large, if N is small, then you may not be able to recover your clusters. And Nicolas was able to show that we can be robust to a squared number of, we have to have at least, N has to be at least a square of the dimension. And if you add sparsity, you can lower this by quite a bit by assuming that you have a sparse clustering vector. Then, so why, the reason why I really like that framework is that you can add extra constraints. So if you know a bit about your problem, and this has been known for quite a while in the semi-supervised learning, then if you deal with this equivalence matrix with a bunch of ones and minus one, if you know if two points are together, you force the entry ij to be one. if you know the points are in different clusters, you force the matrix to be minus one. All of this is convex, so we can simply run the exact same algorithm, and now we get something which can do semi-supervised learning. So here, what I really like in that framework is that it can deal with any amount of supervision. It can go from zero, just pure clustering, to full supervision, which is just like running the least square SVM. And this can adapt to the entire set of problems. And here, this is like a situation in a semi-supervised clustering. The goal is to cluster, and we add a bit of information, and it's much more robust than k-means. You can do the opposite. You want to do semi-supervised classification, where the goal is I want to classify points, and I get the labels on a few of those. For us, this is the exact same problem, but the goals are a bit different. And here, so this is super outdated because it's comparing with methods from 2004. But the idea here is that these methods works reasonably well if you have no supervision. It's just plain clustering, and does do better if you get more labels. The details are not so important, but you get better test error as we increase the number of points, and sometimes significantly more than other problems. So if you want more like recent extensions, you can look at the papers by Armand. We will talk today, later. Okay. Has he arrived? Or? Okay, good.
I hope so.
You hope so? Okay, good. All right, so let's go down to something which is maybe like more concrete. So first image, co-segmentation. So here, the goal, so this is joint work with Armand Joulin and Jean Ponce. Here, the goal is to segment images. So give me an image. I want to assign like a value foreground, background to every pixel in the image. And if you just go from scratch, this is quite a hard problem. And typically, you get something like this. So if you do purely bottom-up segmentation, you get something which is not working very well. And there's been two lines of work to improve on this. Either you label some of the points, a bit like in Photoshop, or this is what we do in co-segmentation. You provide a bunch of images with a similar object. So we only tell the algorithm that I know a bunch of images for which I have a similar object, and I want to segment all of them together. And this is a goal of co-segmentation. So this can be immediately cast as a discriminative clustering problem with some structure. So we want to assign a label to every point of all of the images. So we have, like, let's say, 20 images. We assign labels to all the pixels. But we have to put some constraints so that there is some sharing between the images. So you want to... You want first to impose that you have both foreground and background in all of the images. You may want to have some special structure in your labels because they want to respect like you have an image, and this is trivial if you work with quadratic forms in your label vector because you can simply use a normalized cut prior. And of course, if you want to work with real images with a million pixels, we use superpixels to lower this to 10,000. So at the end, and I've already said this once, is that the key here is that you reuse what has been known to work in the supervised setup. In particular, all those features can be really tuned on the supervised setup. So since this was work from like 7 years ago, what was working well at the time was SIFT with bag of words. But if I were to do the exact same work now, I would just replace this by CNNs. And I believe that this should be done at least by someone that knows about CNN. And on top of this, there are also extensions. So here we did the plain like image segmentation, but we have extended this with, in particular, Piotr Bojanowski and Armand Joulin to situations where you want to cluster, for example, videos, and you know where the segments ought to be because they have partial information, and you want to fully label something which is only weakly labeled. And I believe those techniques are really adapted because they allow you to look at particular sub-vectors of Y. So let's look at a simple like image. So this is we start with two images. So we're going to co-segment those two images. We first do a bit of superpixels. Okay, then we run our diffrag algorithm. So this, I guess, this is 1,000 superpixels, or maybe 300. And we get take the largest eigenvector of our equivalence matrix. So we relax the problem, learn this big n by n matrix, get the eigenvector threshold, and we obtain the two bears or dogs, or not bears, okay, whatever. The two bears with no, so here the goal is that if you were to give that image only, it is the algorithm may have like cut over there, but since we give the fact we give two images of the same class of objects, then you can recover the two segments correctly. This works also for flowers. Okay, so we give only like those, we give only the images, and this co-segments all the images together. So you may say the yellow makes it easy. I agree. It also works on cows. And on cows, we have a bunch, give a bunch of cows, like row by row, and then you manage to segment all of the cows with no prior information. So here's the goal. The key is that we don't tell anything except that there should be a common object in the image. All right, so let's now go to the topic of the workshop. So I have 10 minutes left, I guess. And so this is like pre-clustering for large numbers of classes. So here, so the idea is we're going to be a hierarchy of classes on top of your classes. So let's say you have 1 million classes, and it's going to be a problem at many levels. It's going to be a problem because you may have to run, like, find 1 million predictors, and this will be at training time, but this will also be a problem at test time, because now at test time, your classifier will have a complexity which is linear in the number of classes. So one simple way to lower the complexity of those problems is to try to divide the space of classes, the set of classes, in small pieces. Okay, so you may, for example, like split in two sets of classes which are like well separated, then split again in two, and at the end, the hope is to get like a logarithmic complexity in terms of the number of classes. And now the question is, how do I take my data, which is fully labeled, I have a bunch of observations X, Y, where X is my input, my features, and Y are my the labels for those for every image. How do I split in two? So splitting in two means I have to find clusters of classes that will be maximally separated. And if you think carefully, this is exactly the problem of discriminative clustering, but where I enforce that all the points in the same class have to belong to the same cluster, and the points in different classes. No, there is not minus one, so I should remove that one. Okay, so this is a mistake. So I may be from different classes, okay, but in the same cluster of classes. So at the end, okay, start again. You have k classes, you separate in two. Within a group, you want everybody to be together, okay? Between groups, you want everybody to be together. But it's okay to be in different classes and to be in the same cluster. So you should remove that minus one there, it's totally wrong. But at the end, it's still an instance of discriminative clustering. You can simply run the SM algorithm. And the beauty of it is that because we can collapse, this is the beauty of these squares, you can collapse all labels which are in the same cluster together. Then you can collapse to a k by k problem. So if you start with a huge number of data points, you only need to solve a k by k semi-definite program. Of course, to compute the matrix of that k by k semi-definite program, you have to look at your entire data set. Okay, so you have to run like several like SVMs, but at the end, in terms of complexity in k, this is reasonable. So this is for the split into two. You see, when you split your classes into two blocks, then you can recursively do this by recursive splitting. And at the end, once we have this recursive split, we have to learn the classifiers. Okay, so we could keep the square loss classifiers, but since we apply this to language data, we have a lot where the classes are just words. We use like log loss, so we use like logistic regression. We can also do like bottom-up learning, which I won't describe. And now we describe some results which we obtained with the student Anil Nelakanti, which I co-advised with Guillaume Bouchard, Cédric Archambault, at the time when they were at Xerox. And let's look at how it works. So this is like experiments on the news dataset, AP News, with like 2,000 classes. So here, what you see is different techniques. So we're going to consider a representation of my predictions as a tree. So at the first level, if I do depth zero, this means that all classes are considered being independent. So this is a regular multi-class SVM. And as I increase the depth, this means that I keep my problems. If I take depth one, I've separated my problem in two pieces, where the first classifier will select which piece I am in, and then at the lower layer, I'm going to have a classical multi-class problem. If I am at depth 3, I go on like this, and this we tried, the heat tried several depths, and we computed both accuracy, so higher is better, and median log loss, which is lower, is better. Then we compare several techniques. The first one is flat, so essentially no splits. Rand is a random split, so you take your classes randomly, split them in two. Obio is something which is bottom-up, but which may be unbalanced, and this will come like when I look at the right slides. You want like to separate the classes in species, in the hierarchy, but if the, you want to maintain balance, otherwise it may be inefficient. And then we compare to our technique with two different versions, and I will mostly look at that one. So as you increase the depth, not only you will be more efficient, but it turns out that you predict better. Okay, so this is not always the case. We have many other sets where we split the classes in several pieces and it performs worse, but here it does better. Random does better for a while. Random does better for a while. This is like the whatever color this is. So random does better, but then does worse than the flat hierarchy. So here it's a favorable case where the gains in computational time also led to a gain in accuracy. And the right, I will just again, this is a gain in computational time, which I will not describe. So just to conclude, I presented like this class of techniques, which I call discriminative clustering. So this started at NIPS 12 years ago by Xu and colleagues. And this leads up to a semi-definite program. And you should not be scared of that program. It can be solved like reasonably efficiently. I presented some analysis and applications to some situations. And I really like this weekly supervised learning. And we have done several extensions with some of our students, both for audio, for video, and for images. And the key here, and let me end with a trivial statement, the square loss is jointly convex. Okay, so what this means that if you have a partial knowledge of Y and a partial knowledge, if you have a partial knowledge of Y, and if you optimize over what you don't know about Y, this remains a convex problem. Okay, so among the losses, this is like one of the few losses which is jointly convex, and this allows like all of those like researchers to design algorithms for weak supervision. I believe this is really a problem. We have a large output is that often you only observe a sub vector, and this is a class of technique which works very well for this. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Francis, for the talk. Are there any questions?
Is there a connection between your work and posterior regularization?
I don't know what posterior regularization is. So
the other name was generalized expectation, but they were in a log space, not in a square space.
Okay. I'd be happy to have a look.
I mean, it's not obvious. I was just curious about it.
Any other question? I'm curious if it is possible to relax this in case you consider classes that are multi-model, for example, so that some classes can be in different, examples of some classes can appear in different clusters?
If you're multi-model, the only way I would think of doing it is to add a feature to allow for multimodality. So in the linear case, you add quadratics and you can deal with multi-model. So it's a cheap trick, but it's very hard to, if you look for, at the end, if you have a linear classifier, it's very hard to combine it with multimodalities. So if you're multimodal, you have to add better features. So.
Thank you. Okay, let's thank the speaker.